Welcome back, guys. We was out the other day and we had an electrical fire from our bilge pump. We was motoring along and obviously because the boat's playing in, the bow's in the air, all the water goes to the back. I lifted a hatch, I could see like a bit of water basically, and I thought, right, it's a good time to put the bilge pump on. So we put the bilge pump on, left it 30 seconds or something, lifted the hatch again to see if the water had gone. So the water had gone, but what was there was a flame about yay big. I was like, I didn't know we had a light down there. So yeah, because we turned the bilge pump on, it basically went up in smoke. So we're motoring along about 30 knots. I see the fire. Shout to Gemma, turn the bilge pump off, turn it off, turn the power off. And she went, I have done, it is off, and it was still on fire. So the fire was coming from these wires here. So that was attached around there somewhere, and all this was on fire. So we was all dead calm. Gemma basically come over with a fire extinguisher, said, do you need this? So I basically put out with my hands. So the thing that was actually on fire was the insulation. So for the insulation to be on fire, that means there was a high resistance in the connection between the supply and the pump. So that obviously got hot when I gave it a command to turn the pump on. So yeah, it all went out. It was a bit it wasn't dramatic. It could have been more dramatic. Obviously we've got extinguishers, which if the fire had taken a hold, it would have put it out, but it would have made a right mess, wouldn't it? But yeah, that was quite entertaining. So whenever I have a problem like that, and it's like, oh, it's basically someone's bodged up them. Well, we'll have a good look, but what I think is it's someone's just sort of not done a very good job of wiring the new pump in, because obviously people change pumps periodically, don't they? Pumps go wrong, and I think it's a bad wiring job. Generated high resistance, which then got hot and then ignited the insulation tape, I think was the main culprit. But yeah, so what we're going to do is change the whole system. Another bad thing about this system is it relies on the battery isolators to be on, which I don't think is a very good thing. It should just be like, no matter what, your bilge pumps will run. Because like, you might have an electrical fire somewhere else, you want to turn all the batteries off, turn everything off to isolate the actual cause of the fire, but you might be sinking at the same time. So the last thing you want to do is turn the batteries off and then you've got no pumps. So yeah, we're going to change the whole system, so let's do it. So we've gone for seaflow pumps. So we've got a new switch. So basically it's float switch. We've got a new dash mount switch with a 15 amp breaker in it. So I quite like the idea of having a breaker rather than a fuse, because basically if a fuse blows, you're running around panicking trying to find a fuse, and you probably haven't got one to hand, have you? But a breaker, if there is a problem and then you fix the problem, you can reset the breaker, can't you? So we've also got one of their pumps, it's 1100 gallons per hour. And the thing I like about these ones as well, they have a little joker valve, a lot of check valve in them. So I think we'll start by fitting the pump and the switch in the aft bilge now, and then we'll move to the engine room pump and switch. So there's not much to see, but you can obviously see where it actually went wrong. Something went to ground somewhere, didn't it? They all look a bit skinny, the wires. But yeah, it's definitely there somewhere. Right, let's put a new system in it. So it's been joined here, and it's been joined here as well in the past. So just be careful, if you fit in a new pump, make sure you've got decent connectors and stuff like that. Nothing can possibly touch together. You've got to bear in mind it's potentially swimming in salt water. Right. Let's get to making this right. to clean. I think that'll do, won't it? I think if Gemma was here, she'd have me like painting the build, wouldn't she? It'd be nice to reuse one of the original holes, which we can do. So if we orientate that somehow like that, we should be able to get it on. Bit of an awkward place to work here. So the next one is forward in the engine room. So I'm going to fit that one off camera. Bit awkward down there. Even though that works fine, but I'm going to change it. We'll just change it. Right, so we've got the pump and the switch fitted now in the bilge. I gave it a tiny little clean. Get the sun. Unusual thing to have in the sky, isn't it? Give it a tiny clean. But what we need to do now is try and run some wires now to the helm so we can put the two switches in. So we know the wires have got to come from the pump up there, and I think we're going to go up there, then it'll go through this little compartment here and then up to the helm. So let's get this off. Yeah. Forgot that was under there. The fancy Raymarine stuff. So yeah, we can take advantage of these holes. Wires come up. So I've already run the cable to the aft. We need three cores, don't we? We need a ground, we need a permanent live that runs this. And when the switch operates, it runs the pump. And then we need to do like a signal wire to basically override the switch so we can just go pump. So this one's going to be for the engine room one now. Oh yeah. There you are.
Sounding worse than rain on this canopy.
Okay, so we've got our ground, our permanent live which goes through the switch, and our switchable live which also goes to the live side of the pump, which turns the pump and then also gives a signal back to the switch on the dash which lights it up basically. So we'll leave a light up for now. We've gone and painted the switches, just got to make sure it runs, I've not messed up the wires. Alright, let's go and do that.
This is a set of problems now.
Right, so we're at the point now of mounting switches. So we've got like an auto that'll just control if water comes in, it'll pump it out. And then we can go to manual, press and hold, and it'll pump, which is good. But where do we put them? So everyone's saying, put them there, it's fine there. But in a few episodes' time, what we're going to be doing is remodeling the whole dashboard, because I think the dashboard is the most dated part of the boat. Looks old, doesn't it, and thingy. And it's got normal analog gauges. Analog gauges are brilliant if you're looking at them. If you're not looking at them, you could be spiking temperature, you could be low in oil pressure, you could be running out of fuel. So what I wanted was something to give me alerts. We've got these little things on the side which have actually gave us some trouble, which are basically giving us some false alerts by saying like the fuel's low and stuff like that. So you don't really trust them. So what we've got, it's not for this episode, we've got a Veritrum, which that basically converts all the analog signals into digital signals, and then it'll display all your engine data on that screen. So this here is going to be replacing all of these analog gauges. Obviously I haven't got time to do it just yet, but then we're going to mount the chart plotter here as well to make it look really slick. What I did want to do was put another chart plotter, so I have two chart plotters side by side, and then mount this and completely remodel the dash. So it's like a complete glass dashboard, but we can't afford to buy another 12-inch Axiom. They're quite expensive. So I think for now what we need to do is just hash these in. We need to sort of make them work, don't we? But obviously safe, we've got wires hanging out the back of them and stuff like that. So if we just get these in for now, and then hopefully in the next couple of episodes we actually pull the dash off, cut it all up, rewire it completely. So quite looking forward to it. It's going to be an interesting job. I love digital dashboards. Right, let's get to cutting some holes. Right, I've chickened out. I can't bring myself to cut a hole in my dashboard, because I'm thinking, well, what if this goes here and this goes here and this goes here? I might be cutting a hole where I didn't actually want a hole. Obviously, it'd be good if we could figure out exactly where these are going to go, but I want to prioritise the space for the Axiom. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to chicken out for now. I found a piece of material, and I think I'm just going to mount them there for now. I know it looks a bit rubbish, they're not in the optimal position, but just to save making a right mess, because this is all alley and it's going to be hard to cut. So if I just hash it up for now, make it safe, and we've got the switches, yeah, that'll do for now. I hate saying that'll do, but it is genuinely temporary. Go on then, let's do a bodge. Beautiful. There we go, so we'll just run that there for now until we can commit to where they're going on the dash. Okay, so I'm going to wire this on now, but I'm going to leave the wires dead long so they can be shortened and be manoeuvred onto the dashboard. Well, let's get this done. So I've got my wires there now, they're massively long so we can extend them to the dash. But all they need to do is get to here for now, but we'll leave them long, we'll basically tie them up for now. Got myself a permanent live, so that's fused from the back of the battery switch, so the unswitched side of the battery switch, that's fused there, so that'll be permanently live, and if we ever want to turn it off, whatever, we can pull the fuse. Got ourselves a ground, and obviously the two pump wires. Right, I'm going to connect all these up now, and then we can give it a test. So we're going to be jumping to the wires on now. I'm unsure with the polarity of these two, because depending on the position of the switch, whether it's in auto or manual. So I think what we need to do is power it up, and then we'll plug them in, and then we'll see if it runs. So, there you go, all light comes on, auto. You get a manual, then there's a red light comes on. So I think the red light means the pump's running. Obviously it's not at the moment because we haven't got the ones on the back. So let's put them on to auto. So they're both on auto now. So hopefully there's the blue wire. I can hear a pump running on the blue wire. So that's on auto. So technically we need it, that wire to go there. And now this one should do nothing until we activate the switch. Right, is he doing this one handed? So now, if we press it into manual, can you hear the pump running? So when we put it into auto, it doesn't do anything, but it's on standby now. So they're both on auto now. So let's go and lift the float switches and see if the pump runs. Then we've done it right, if it does. So in theory now, yeah. Let's check the engine room one. Oh yeah. So let's see if the little warning light comes on. See if I can reach it. I don't know which pump switch. There you go, you can see a little red light comes on when the pump's running. So we could also set that to an alarm as well, so like an audio, audible, whatever, alarm, so it beeps when the pump's running. So if you're going along, it starts beeping, you start panicking then, don't you? Check out the posh switches. Right, so it's all buttoned up now. I'm tired of the wiring up. I need to bring some P-clips from the workshop. But then if you can see, it's a bit tidier. I just want to clip it up. Same in the engine room. Now we need to test them, don't we? What we're going to do is put some water into the bilge, make sure they pump. Because obviously there's no point in having them if they don't pump, if there's something wrong. Might be going backwards, might it? What I was going to do, right, was I was going to undo the sea chest, open the valve, let water flood into the hull, and then put it on a loop to freak you guys out, but that wouldn't be fair, would it, at all? So yeah, what we're gonna do is use the hose pipe instead of seawater. So I was gonna open the valve and let water come in. Anyway, that was my idea. So let's give them a test. Let's pour a load of water into the bilge and then we'll see if they pump. So good water pressure here at Degamway. Well, it's gonna take a minute, isn't it? It's not even nowhere near the pump yet. So I've been filling up the aft bilge. And for some reason I thought they weren't connected. Does that make sense? It makes sense to build a boat like that, wouldn't it? So if you flood one, then you've still got the buoyancy of the other one. But I've just been filling that up. And I've just looked in the engine room bilge. And that's got loads of water in it. So that's something I need to look into. That I don't think that should be happening. Anyway, so we've got loads of water down there now. So we've got to keep filling up the engine bilge. Oh. I forgot to say ages ago as well, I put an alarm on it, so if water gets in there, it sets an alarm off and alerts someone. Never know, just in case. But I've just wet it. So now filling the bilge from the back of the engine room. It's gonna take a bit, innit, for it to trigger the pump. Ah. 1st, so with all the commotion of that alarm going off, the pump kicked in. Now it's just emptied the bilge. Now it's turned itself off. So that's a good sign. It's turned itself on, turned itself off. And it took ages to fill that, and it emptied it in seconds, but with the commotion of the alarm going off, I couldn't actually hear the pump running. So let's put a bit more in, and then we'll put it onto manual, and we'll see it coming out the side. So that's an automatic now. I've got the hose pipe running inside constantly. Right, I'll just give the deck a quick hose down as well, as it was full of all sorts of nasties. It's amazing how much a white deck just shows every bit of rubbish. Right, thanks for watching. So hopefully next time we don't have any little fires.